Eric Bauer is the second PhD student at Dartmouth graduated, and he's now a postdoc at Lawrence Livermore National Labs, and he's going to talk about his current research, finding hard defects in C++ programs. Some still write C++ programs with defects. Okay.
Thank you, Jakub. Good morning. I'm going to talk about dynamic error detection, and more specifically, I talk about our tool called CERM, which stands for Code Instrumentation and Runtime Monitoring. CERM is developed at the Rostock Pilot Group at the Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory. My talk is essentially structured in two major parts. The first part talks about how we instrument dimension code, and the second part talks about how we extend the system for parallel codes. Bugs come in a wide variety of forms in many different ways. This slide shows a very simple bug, where a function returns an invalid address. And more specifically, the function computes first a value and stores it in a local variable, then it returns the address of the variable to the caller. And if the caller immediately dereferences the variable, you might even still get a valid value. However, in a more complex context, this can become a hard bug that is hard to spot. The main motivation for this work is that finding bugs is expensive, it's tedious, and it's time-consuming. In 2002, a study showed that 0.6% of the national GDP is spent on detecting bugs in software. And that's a huge number, that's about $60 billion. Since then, we have seen the emergence of many bug detection tools, and also we have seen the development of error detection benchmark suites that help to assess bug detection tools. There are several benchmark suites that exist. At Livermore, we use the ARTED suite that is developed at Iowa State University, and we use ARTED because it covers essentially the range of languages that the labs are interested in. And that includes C++, Fortran, and UPC. We can categorize bug detection tools along a number of dimensions, for example, whether they use static analysis or dynamic analysis, whether they operate on source code or analyze binary code. This slide mentions a couple of tools that are more popular, and I apologize if I don't have your favorite tool on the slide. So in essence, static analysis analyzes a program without executing it. However, the large state space becomes prohibitively expensive, and we cannot always get precise results. On the other side, we have dynamic analysis. However, dynamic analysis depends on concrete input values. And so the quality of the analysis results depend on the quality of the input values. There are also more interesting combinations of static and dynamic analysis. For example, we can use static analysis to eliminate unnecessary checks at runtime. Or we can use static analysis to drive the generation interesting input sets. CERM right now is mainly a dynamic analysis tool, a tool that operates on source code. And we choose to operate on source code because we believe that it's easier to port the tool to various architectures compared to porting a tool that operates on binary code. In sequential code, we can detect the following error categories. Mainly we detect system errors. With system errors, I mean errors that depend on operations that are not well defined within the language. For example, excesses of arrays out of bounds, or excesses of uninitialized variables, excesses through dynamic pointers, and so on. We can also detect invocations of C library functions that use invalid arguments, where the arguments violate the specified preconditions. And also we can find mismatches in memory allocation and deallocation methods. For example, if you allocate a stack variable and free it using the operator delete. In order to instrument the code, we use the ROS compiler analysis infrastructure. ROS is similar to the pivot that is developed here at Texas A&M. ROS has a number of frontends for languages that are interesting to the DOE, and also we have a frontend for binary code. In essence, the frontends process the input files generate the intermediate representation in form of an EST. AST can be analyzed and manipulated. And at the end, we have an unclass that regenerates a source file in the specified input language. This slide shows the architecture of our code instrumentation and runtime monitor tool. First, we take in some source code that can be either some test programs or programs that come from the benchmark suite. We run this code through the instrumentation path of course, and we add function calls that help us monitor changes to the system state and also validate some potentially harmful operations. The result of this instrumentation path is what we call monitor source code. And the monitor source code can be compiled with any third-party compiler. The result is monitor binary code that gets linked to a runtime monitor that we provide. So at runtime, the runtime monitor gets invoked with changes to the system state and keeps a hold of the system essentially. It also gets invoked with requests to validate some certain operations that could be harmful. And if a harmful operation is detected, the running program gets aborted. So I would like to go back to the initial example and show how we instrument the code. The first step is to keep track of the variables that are allocated. To do that, we notify the runtime monitor about the address of the variable, about the type, and also that it was initialized. Then we need also to keep track of the lifetime of variables. In C++, we use the RAII mechanism. So essentially, we instrument every scope with a scope guard, and the destructor of the guard notifies the runtime monitor about all the variables that are going on in scope. And finally, in order to validate that the return pointer is invalid, we wrap the original function in another function. First, we call that function, and when the function returns, we validate that the pointer address that gets returned is still a valid address. So this slide essentially concludes the first part of the talk where I showed how we instrument sequential code. We also extended the system to handle parallel code in the context of UPC. UPC is a distributed programming language, and UPC extends the C99 language with the notion of partition global address space. In the partition global address space model, each UPC thread has still its own private stack and private heap, similar to a regular C or C++ program. But in addition, it also has a portion of the global shared memory space. And any thread can concurrently access that shared memory space with random read and random write operations. In addition, UPC also adds language constructs that help the programmers deal with parallelism. This includes pointers that point to the shared memory. It includes parallel for loops, memory consistency models, and also mechanisms that help programmers control locality. Currently, we have implemented a system that can detect C-style errors that occur in the UPC shared space. What we have not implemented at the moment are parallelism-related errors such as deadlocks, live locks, and race conditions. However, I would like to emphasize that while we cannot detect race conditions directly, we can detect errors that occur in programs where race conditions are present. And also, what we have not yet implemented, checking of invocations of UPC library functions in the same way that we currently check C functions. In order to handle UPC, we extended the system in a way that each UPC thread has its own runtime monitor. The runtime monitor stores the information about the local stack and local heap, and also the information about the shared global space. Whenever a thread updates the shared global space, the runtime monitor communicates with its peers and sends this information to the other runtime monitors. So how does this work? I will show with a small code example. In the first line, here, all threads allocate together shared space. So this is a collective operation. And therefore, in the next line, we notify the runtime monitor that the heap was created in form of a collective heap allocation. since the operation was collective, all runtime only does not know about this information, and there's no communication needed. The next line here initializes the shared pointer, the local pointer that points to the shared heap. Again, since this is a local pointer, there's no communication needed. In the next steps, we check that the following array accesses within bounds. Since this is not a state update, again, there's no communication needed. And only after we initialize this field, we change the system state and the runtime monitors start communicating with each other. Since in the system, we essentially write to a memory location and then there's a delay until the messages are being sent and processed by the runtime monitors, the question arises whether this system is sufficient to guarantee that at all times whether a memory location has been initialized gives the precise value, the precise result. And let's consider this example. On top of the source code, a thread initializes a specific shared memory location. It tells this to the runtime monitor, and the runtime monitor sends messages to the other runtime monitors. At the bottom of the code, another thread reads this memory location. And here we need to know that the first memory location was initialized. Since this code uses barriers, and the barriers guarantee, before getting to the barrier, that the first thread has communicated and sent the messages to the other runtime monitors. And the exit of the barrier guarantees all other runtime monitors have processed these messages and have updated their internal state. So, in this case, this is sufficient to guarantee that the barrier can be checked in the second thread at the bottom of the code. However, what happens if we remove the barrier? In this case, it can happen that the first thread initializes the barrier and broadcasts the messages to the other runtime monitors. However, we might have not processed it at the moment when they check whether the value has been initialized. However, in this case, the code contains a race condition, and therefore we allow the runtime monitor to spuriously report an error, although it might actually have been properly initialized. A very similar problem can occur with freeing or deallocating memory. And this is actually potentially more harmful because if there's a race condition that frees memory while other threads concurrently access that memory, then this could lead to bad problems. So the way we handle this case is that we carry out the deallocations in an isolated manner. And that works in the following way, that before the memory is deallocated, the runtime monitor communicates this to its peers. The other monitors acknowledge it, and only when all the acknowledgments have been received, the memory can be freed. We have implemented the system for GCC, UPC, but in general, the implementation is portable, except for some implementation details where we have to convert local pointers to the shared memory shared memory pointers, which the UPC standard doesn't allow. So in these cases, we have to rely on some implementation-specific mechanisms. We have validated our approach by testing it against the RTET runtime error detection benchmark suite, and in general, we can handle about 90% of all the test cases for most of the error categories. And by handling, I don't mean that we only report the program, but we also can pinpoint the memory, the source code location where the error occurred. In a similar way, we can handle more than 90% for all UPC error categories that are important to us. So while initially the project was geared for correctness, we also tested the performance against the UPC code that performs that is a heat conduction code. And in essence, the heat conduction contains two grids where the first grid is initialized, and then in odd number of time steps, the second grid is computed based on the values in the first grid, and in even number of time steps, the process is reversed to the first grid. The values in the first grid are computed from the values in the second grid. We You can distinguish three phases in the program. The first one is the initialization phase, where we initialize the first grid. The second phase is the first iteration, where we compute the first time the values in the second grid. And the third phase is when all the shared memory locations have been initialized, then there's no need for runtime monitors communicating with each other because the system state that we record doesn't change any longer. So we see that the performance impact is quite significant. If we run 20 iterations, then we have an overall impact of roughly of a factor of 140. And this is significant, and we would like to improve these results in the future. So we tested some simple static analysis methods that help us eliminate some of those runtime checks. And with those methods, we can improve the performance by factor of 2, which means an overall slowdown of about a factor of 60. To do that, we used the following three analysis tactics. For example, if we know that the use of a variable has a region definition, we can eliminate the local initialization checks. If we know that a variable is only used within a function context and it doesn't escape, and that all uses of this variable have a region definition, we can eliminate the variable tracking altogether. And finally, by performing some interval analysis, we can improve the response checking and eliminate some of those checks. Also, the current implementation cleanly separates the instrumented source code from the runtime monitor. So any check whether the operation is harmful invokes the runtime monitor and that crosses the compile time translation unit boundary. So we experimented with a different approach of instrumenting code, where we essentially include the checks in the instrumented code, and we implemented this for arithmetic, overflow and underflow checks, and the result is that we can carry out those checks with an overhead of only 20% compared to non-checking code. To conclude, I've presented our tool CERB that detects runtime errors. In the future, we would like to integrate more static analysis to help eliminate unnecessary checks in sequential codes. But what's more important is we want to improve the static analysis for parallel codes so that we can eliminate some of the checks and some of the more expensive synchronization methods. Also, we would like to add some static analysis in order to reduce the communication overhead that is incurred by runtime monitors communicating with each other. Thank you, and I would be happy to answer any questions that you may have. For example, Purify or M2++.
For example, whatever one's favorite tool is.
Veltran operates on binary code. That's one difference. Our tool is open source. That's another difference. And we handle parallel codes essentially in UPC, which I think we are the first tool that addressed this.
Right, that's right.
Have you tried putting this over any of the larger open source projects that are available online to see how you're finding errors in real world code? Large real world code.
We haven't proceeded to that stage yet.
You said you were also going to do this for the data races and all the general parallel problems that you can have. Now, given the performance hit won't that change the profile of the program being run in such a way that the problems that you would have in an unmonitored program will not appear under the monitor because the progress of it is the execution times?
That's probably the case for dynamic analysis, yes. But for static analysis, we can detect codes where there may be no race condition. And so by doing that, we can eliminate some of the